studying classical, practicing 8 hours a day. I couldn't commit to that. There was too much else that excited me. It was rock and roll. It was jazz music. I was eating, you know, cereal in my pajamas, sitting on the counter, and my manager calls, "Your song is number one."
Happy spring, New York Realers. Enjoy the beautiful view here. My guest in this episode is Tracy Bonham. She has received 2 Grammy nominations with her debut album in 1996 called The Burdens of Being Upright. She started singing when she was 5. She learned violin when she was 9. And she started playing piano when she was 14. So she's classically trained, but has a very edgy alternative vibe. And if you meet her in person, you'll be surprised how down to earth she is. She's so funny. I think she's the coolest person. Without further ado, I'm gonna present to you my interview with Tracy Bonham. Hope you enjoy it.
So nice and out of tune.
Yeah, I gotta thank Rachel for introducing us to
Rachel Yamagata.
This is New York Real. I'm Olive. Today my guest is Tracy Bonham. You are my alternative rock music legend. I really look up to you.
Oh, thank you. That's nice.
And you have been nominated for the Grammys and also MTV Music Awards. You have your number one single, Mother Mother, which is an anthem to a lot of people, a lot of especially women. You are a mother yourself now, and you divide your time in upstate New York and Brooklyn. I just can't wait to speak with you. Welcome to New York Real.
Thank you. I'm looking forward to this.
So, Tracy, I have noticed that there are a lot of opposite themes in your music, in your life, like the suburb, the city, like you're classically trained, you're a great violinist, and you're also really alternative and in the rock genre. And a bit of everything. How do you learn to balance everything in your musical career and in your life?
Well, I think it's a good thing to have contrast and to have balance. And it's probably my fear of full committing to something. But I guess I've learned to work and for my advantage. So when I was growing up and I was playing classical violin and I got the full scholarship and I went down to University of Southern California and I was studying classical and I was practicing 8 hours a day, I couldn't commit to that whole life. I just couldn't. There was too much else that excited me, and it was the dark side.
Uh-huh.
It was rock and roll. It was jazz music, you know. So that's when I had my first feeling of this schizophrenic, like, who am I? You know, when I was 18, I'm like, who am I? But I learned to kind of find that balance, and that's kind of cool. That's awesome. And then there's the dogs.
Because nobody's someone...
here. Yeah. Guys, thank you. Thank you so much. Sorry.
Anyway. No, we have had dogs and cats.
You've had dogs and cats?
Episodes, yeah.
Okay, good. But that was probably... Nobody knew there was a dog until like 2 dogs started barking and killed everybody's ears.
Yes. But,
okay,
so
sorry.
When you were around 18, so yeah. you felt the two sides...
Yeah.
The darker side,
yes,
the rebellious side.
The devil and the angel right
and
here.
And the traditional classical side.
Yes.
How did you learn to make the decisions? Like, did you learn from your teachers, or do you always know what you want?
Ooh. I think deep down I always know what I want, but I have the plague of trying to please people. the affliction of trying to please people, and that muddies everything up. So at that time, I was trying to please my parents. I was very confused. Okay, they want me to play the violin. You know, I told them I was going to maybe be a symphony player, and they were excited about the stability of that. Mm-hmm. And when I told my parents and my stepdad specifically that, nope, I want to be a singer. I'm going to move to Boston, and I want to be a singer. And my dad said, be prepared to starve. And, you know, so then I was like going against the grain, but it was pulling me and I couldn't not do it. So then I just took a chance. I got on an airplane and I went to Boston and I started kind of going down the dark path.
So in college, you ended up choosing voice, right?
Yeah. Yeah. At Berklee College of Music, I chose voice, which was an interesting choice that I could go into if you wanted me to or not.
Yeah. Sure.
Well, Berklee is a school that has a great reputation, right? And everybody says, oh, Berklee College of Music. But at that time, for voice specifically, it was not a great place to be. You know, just kind of lack of good teachers. And at that time, and it may be the same now, but students didn't really, they weren't proficient on their instruments. And maybe I was a snob because I'd come from a conservatory atmosphere. I was very snobby. But I looked around me and I thought, like, God, some of these people have only been singing or playing their instrument for 6 months. And it just felt like a trade school.
Wow.
Yeah, I know. Ooh, speak out against Berklee. But I think it's gotten better now. And I think it also depends on the teacher and it depends on your instrument.
I feel like we all felt that way about some of our college courses or teachers.
I bet, yes, yes, right.
But then we look back and we see, like, I don't remember everyone, but those that I remembered really taught me something and I love them. And the school usually hate them.
Yes, you know what, right, they're with the oddballs or something. Yeah. I know what you mean. And I have the same thing. I have the really weird oddballs that were maybe counterculture or something. Mm. Maybe they would even speak out against the school or whatever. But they were amazing teachers. And it's the same thing.
Do you remember their names?
Yes. Well, golly. Well, there's one teacher who's still there who's now the head of he was the head of the string department at Berklee College of Music. So I did play violin still. Mm-hmm. And then he went on to be the head of the American Roots program. That was a new thing and a new major in the last 10 years or so. His name is Matt Glazer, and he's incredible. And he's just a total goofball, but I love him very much.
Well,
yeah.
You're in touch?
Yeah, yeah. And he actually started a band later. You know, he's like 20 years older than me, but he started a band and he handpicked who he wanted to be in his band. And some of them were students of his. I was one of them, and others were like world-class banjo pickers and another world-class klezmer clarinetist and drummers. So it's one of my most fun experiences in music, actually.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. That's really cool.
Yeah.
And thinking about the word alternative, what do you think it really means back then and now?
Right.
Is there anything that we can define? We just
Well, back then, I think it was an alternative to the mainstream. Mm. And it was, you know, I mean, it almost had a requisite of being slightly oddball and not, you know, commercial and intentionally not commercial. Mm-hmm. So there were bands like the Pixies. And when I was in Boston, local bands that were really inspiring to me, Throwing Muses and... just, you know, songwriting that was just a little bit off, you know, like taking left turns instead of right and then, you know, surprising you. And that was the most inspiring thing. Just to listen, there was radio stations that would play that, and they were specifically alternative music radio stations. So they were the counterculture stations.
Yes.
And it was exciting. And then what happened slowly after the 90s is that started to kind of fade into or be swallowed by commercial radio. And then it just became kind of distilled and everything now when you think about alternative music. I don't even know what that means.
And we sort of just took the word out and just used the other
descriptions. Well, now it's a brand almost, and then it became kind of popular, became mainstream, so then how do you have the alternative to the alternative? I don't know.
Good point. I was lucky enough to have seen your performance actually live twice, I think. And I really loved that you started your set last time at Rockwood Music Hall with just a violin and yourself and your own singing with when you're playing violin. Like, I don't think I've seen a lot of shows with just that. It's so unique and so simple, but it touches me. Mm. I really like that. How much of violin do you play nowadays, mm-hmm. and how much piano do you play?
I think more than I used to. In the 90s, I didn't, when I was writing my alternative rock songs, I hadn't put it together yet. The violin was there, and I had recorded with it, and I did play it live, but it was more like an afterthought. Mm. With my writing, it changed over the years, and now I write sometimes with the violin or for the violin, and I use that as sometimes the foundation for a song. Mm. And I love arranging string parts, so sometimes a song will be created from writing string parts. The song will be kind of somewhere in there that it'll kind of morph into a song, or it'll be a song that I already know when I'm starting to write it that it wants strings. So I love having that as one of my tools.
When did a melody or lyrics come to you?
It changes. It used to be just melody and chords, usually at the same time. I would sit down with a guitar or a piano, and the chord, even if I didn't know what I was about to do, I would kind of challenge myself to put my hand somewhere. Do you know that one?
I've seen a video of you writing, and you basically just put your hands on the piano, and that's the chord you're going
to
use.
Right, that's kind of what I do. It's almost like I'm a marionette. I'm like, okay, and if I am feeling connected, it can, you know, turn out to be something nice. And I have the theory to know what I'm doing. I could say like, oh, that's a, you know, C minor 7 or whatever, but I don't want to start doing the math because I think it is more spiritual than that, more divine. So I'm
you can just
like,
turn it off?
I can. And then I can just kind of go by shape and feel. And a lot of times I do kind of go to the same thing over and over. I have to kind of stop, clean the slate. But I will just let my hands lead in a way that where I'm trusting that they are going to fall into, you know, the right place. If they don't, then I'll start over. But then that will then inform the melody maker up here to find something, to weave it in, to have it, you know, and it just depends on my mood. Do I want something to float up here? Do I want something kind of in between here? Do you know, and I find it so incredibly difficult to explain my process.
It's like an artist, but you know the back end, all the science about it, but you kind of turn it off.
Definitely turn it off because I don't want it to be formulaic. Mm. I want it to come from that place inside or above. And then, so to answer your question from before, then usually lyrics would come later, and I would sit down with a journal and... a long time ago, I used to do free association, just words, it didn't matter what they were. Mm. And then maybe they would start to make sense. And I miss that. I don't do that as much. Now I'm a little bit more literal, and I have to sit down, and it has to make sense, and I'm like beating my head against the wall. But I really kind of, I miss those days of just throwing, like a collage.
Yeah.
Throwing the words out there, and then kind of trying to figure it out later.
So it changes too.
It does change. And I think it needs to change. One needs to keep it fresh. Otherwise, you're just sitting down and you're doing your punch card. You're clocking in. Yeah. I think
It sounds like something that you've heard before, like just copying.
It can be that too. And then you can get bored with yourself.
I remember when I used to write on piano. in different keys, I was afraid that at the end, because they sound good to me, that I will always go to the same key. So I transcribe them all back to C, to see if I'm always going from C to A to F. And
Tested yourself? Were you doing the same chords?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Well, there are some chord progressions that you just
love so much that you use it all the time.
I hear you. But you can. The melody sometimes will be so different each time that it'll fool you. You don't even know that you're writing the same thing. It's really true. And that's the thing I love about music and songs, are that they can be magical and you cannot even know. Like, and it'll sound so kind of mystical. And how do they do that? I have no idea. And then you sit down and you take it apart and you're like, oh, that's so easy. And I love that. You've got to remove yourself and keep the magic and not get all technical. Yeah.
I love how you just described it. How much of your fans or audience or friends affect your writing?
That's a good question. Well, 20 years ago, when things were different and I had a radio hit and it was being played all over the world, I thought of my fans as a, you know, something out there. It was ethereal. I couldn't put a face to it, but it was kind of a power, a full thing. It was an energy that I continued to try and write to, speak to, but I didn't have a face and I didn't know who it was, you know. I didn't have anything in my mind except, you know, somebody turning on the radio, maybe somebody driving and turning on the radio.
Right.
How are they going to feel when they hear that song when they turn on the radio? And then it started to change into like environments. So I would start to imagine, what would a person feel like if they heard my song in this cafe? So it started to go into rooms. And certain rooms would inspire certain kinds of songs. I've written songs that were specifically inspired by the room and that fictitious person who was sitting there having coffee and going, what's that? Like, what's that bass sound, you know? Mm-hmm. So it was kind of this imaginary audience that was shaped by rooms and, you know, radio waves. But then as things changed and my audience grew smaller, just by the way things happened, my circumstance and stuff, it didn't hit me until maybe last year or 2 years ago that I thought, oh, there's faces. There's actually, you know, it's a small group of people, but they're my people. And they want to hear from me. Because there was a time in between there that was very, I was disillusioned. I didn't know who my fans were, where they were. I wasn't getting radio play.
It's a lot to live up to.
Oh, yeah. Right. The pressure to, exactly. And things were changing in the music business, and it was depressing, and, you know, less and less ticket sales and less albums were being bought, and, you know, for everyone. And I didn't know who I was singing to, and it was kind of important for me. So when I had that moment of like, maybe it's just a group of 500 people, that's okay. Like, it's okay. Yeah, I went from maybe, you know, having like a million to 500, but those 500 care about me. And they want to hear from me. And even if I kind of like don't do my best, they still want to hear from me because they care. And that somehow changed it. And then I was like, I'm going to write for those people, my peeps.
And at shows, do you see the same faces?
I do see a lot. Yeah.
On the East Coast, like they travel to see you.
Yeah, for a while there were some familiar faces, people who would actually travel for a long distance. And now there are other ways of connecting with your fans, too, through the internet, you know, and you can do a show in your living room, and they can be in Holland, or they can be in Germany,
yes,
or,
like,
you know, Australia.
Live streaming.
Yeah, so that's cool, too. And I recognize their names, and I'm like, oh, yeah, you've been a fan since 98, you know, Michelle, oh, my God, that's great.
They
really
probably cool. Feel like you are the best friend.
It's nice. Well, it's nice. I definitely have that tendency to, like, blur the barriers, but sometimes, and I have become friends with some of my super fans.
Yeah.
Like, I've got super fans who have been a fan of mine since, you know, maybe 98. And now, like, we go and have drinks all the time. And we say, I love you. I mean, it's amazing.
Wow. In a way, you used music as a tool and you just connected with a lot of people deeply.
Yeah.
So, Tracy, I have heard a rumor that the music video that won you the nomination of MTV Music Awards, the one that I saw was not the one that I thought was nominated.
Right.
It's a very long sentence. So where's the real music video for Mother Mother?
This is a mystery that I hope that someone watching can solve for me, because it doesn't make sense. And okay, here's the deal. In 1996, I had a video that was directed by a guy named Jake Scott, who has gone on to do, I don't know if he's doing commercials or movies, but he's a very, you know, successful videographer. Is that the right word?
Yeah.
Anyway, so the video that was super popular, that was nominated for the best music video by MTV, was a one-shot video. And it was me, my face, that had been pre-recorded inside a TV set. And I am talking to my mother, who is vacuuming in her pink jumpsuit or tracksuit, and she has no idea I'm there. She's not paying attention to me at all. And she's vacuuming, and she's shaking some of that powdered, scented, you know, vacuum powder.
Your real mother.
My real mother's in the video, too. Yes, so I asked my real mother to be in the video. My stepfather's in the video. He walks by with a golf club. The room is painted green. It's kind of gaudy. It looks like maybe a house in New Jersey in 1978 or something.
Okay.
All the pictures on the walls are of me and my family. And then, so she has no, she's completely oblivious. I'm singing to her in the TV and I'm screaming, "Everything's not!" in the TV. She has no idea. When my stepfather walks through the room, then the camera pans and you know, to have one shot, there's a guy with a steady cam.
No cut, one shot.
Yeah, there's one shot, and there's people running, or they're crouching beneath the couches, and they're going like this, and they're going like this, and they're going like this. And the guy, and even the guy with the camera, there's mirrors. He has to, like, duck out of the way. But as my stepfather walks by the dining room, the band is playing in the dining room and nobody notices them. So there's my bass player's on the table. There's a drummer. I'm actually dressed as a man playing the guitar because I didn't have another guitar player. So that was like the video, and I was super proud of it.
How fun. I don't think I've seen that one. I've seen the other one that has the most views.
Right. So now if you go onto the internet and you Google Tracy Bonham Mother Mother, you're going to see a completely different video.
Yes.
And you're not going to find, unless you dig really deep, you're not going to find the one that was famous. So I don't know what happened to the old one, and it drives me crazy because I have no answer. Except that over time, and this was, you know, pre-digital age,
mm-hmm.
over time, it just, you know, maybe somebody took it off of their server at Island Records or Universal Music, and it just, nobody cared enough to find it. I don't know, but it just disappeared, and it breaks my heart. But there's another version now that you find. And in 1996, my record label, Island Records, my music was not doing well in the UK. They just, Alanis Morissette had already kind of like busted down the doors over there. And the UK, I was told, was like a different animal.
Yeah.
And you had to have some kind of story. If you weren't Alanis, you had to have some kind of story. Like, you had to be a heroin addict. Or you had to like live in your car. And then they're going to be excited about your music. And I think to them, I may have sounded like Alanis. I don't even want to get into that.
People are mistaken.
Yeah, exactly. There's comparisons all the time, and that's a whole other thing. But so my record label wanted to make an alternate version of the video, and that would be only released in the UK.
Okay.
They really thought that the UK audience wouldn't get the humor of me in the TV set, my mom vacuuming. Maybe it looked too American.
Ooh.
Yeah, and they use those words like, you know, the UK wouldn't get the joke, which I find very funny because I think that the people in England are quite funny.
Yes.
Some of the funniest people in my book are like from England. So anyway, that's the version now that is at the top of the list that gets the most hits, and everyone assumes that that's the one that got nominated for the video. for the award.
Wow. So if I dig deep, I will find it.
You will find it. You have to type in something like, you know, official. I've actually tried to go in there and type official, attach it to it. But also there's one that says audio synced. So some sweet fan videotaped their TV set, I think, and then put the audio in later. That's the original version.
I think I might have seen a screenshot of it because you were in...
Inside a TV set. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to look.
Okay, if anyone has the answer...
I'm going to attach a link.
Yes, to something.
So everyone can watch it.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Wow, vintage.
Yeah, vintage, exactly.
Love it. Yeah. And that was 96.
Six, yeah.
And you were nominated with MTV before your Grammy. Right.
I can't remember the order of
things. It was like the year after.
Okay, good. Yeah, right. I think because it was like the Grammys were actually, they happened in 97.
Mm.
I think my album was released in March. I think I had a summer, yeah, that was when the MTV Video Awards, because I remember I was wearing a sun, you know, slinky thing, and I was going to show up on a moped, but I didn't. And then I think as the new year came around in 97, that's when the Grammys happened.
With your first album, was that your first album?
Yeah.
That is just mind-blowing.
Yeah, it was.
That is something like, even nowadays, like, it's been all, you know, musicians look for. do you remember when you were notified that this is happening?
Yeah.
How old were you?
I remember these things where I was. I was 27, I think, back then. And I have memories of where I was. Like, the first time I was sitting on my counter in my pajamas, and I was living in Watertown, Massachusetts, which is a little suburb of Boston. And I was eating, you know, cereal in my pajamas, sitting on the counter, and my manager calls, and he's like, "Your song is number one. It's gone to number one." And so that's that memory. I remember when I found out about the Grammy nominations, that's when fax machines were still in people's homes.
Yeah.
And my dad, who was at work, like, faxed me something like, "Hey, congratulations, kid." And I was like, I don't even know what's happening. I was like, "What?" And then I got the phone call, and I remember there was like many messages on my machine like, "Hey, congratulations." And then
they found out before you.
Yeah, they found out before I did.
Wow.
Yeah. It was an exciting time.
A lot of pajamas theme.
A lot of pajamas. Yeah, well, a lot of like real, you know, moments where, you know, a lot of, you know, people might think that there's this glamour to things, but it's really not. You could be walking your dog and all of a sudden, you know, you find out that you sold 20,000 records that week. Like, what? Those are the memories that I have. And maybe because it is that weird dichotomy, I think it's very interesting.
I just love that you're enjoying both.
Yeah.
Worlds and the magical and the real, and it's the same to you.
That's true, that's right.
And I also love that you're in your yoga outfit today in our interview, and because Thursdays is yoga day.
Every morning, every Thursday morning, like, I cannot get out of it, and I don't want to get out of it. I look forward to this day, and I wish I could do it more often, but my schedule doesn't allow it now.
And how often did you do, and what kind of yoga do you like?
Well, I do a mixture of things. It's Hatha, it's Iyengar. I was trained. I actually got my teaching certificate up in Woodstock, New York. Yeah, and I did a full immersion. It was a 200-hour thing, but it was mostly centered in the Iyengar tradition. A lot of alignment.
I'm only familiar with the vinyasa.
Okay, yes, the flowing thing. Yes, I think that where I go, it incorporates all of that, the vinyasa as well.
Do you like hot yoga?
I love hot yoga. I do. I love walking out of there feeling that I was just wrung out, like I was just massaged and I'm just dripping. But I do have, there's two things I don't love about hot yoga.
The smell.
Thing. Well, the smell. When you walk in, there's one studio that I go to that has carpeting. Can you imagine what that smells like? It's the most disgusting.
That is why I haven't tried Bikram.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's disgusting. It's dirty foot yoga, I call it. So I'm not going back there. And
the wooden floors are great.
The wooden floor would be great. And I know it gets slippery, but whatever. Deal with it. carpeting's got to go. And then the other thing that I do not like is that in Bikram, certain teachers, they stick by the rule book so much, and if they notice, this is very technical, but they like you, I think they want you to kind of extend your knee, like they actually want your knees to be straight sometimes. But like almost locking your knees, which I find to be very bad, especially in the heat, because you can actually damage and hurt yourself.
There was one class when a teacher said,
"Were they getting lock on your knees?"
Well, not a big room, but, and I was like, when should I ever lock my knee?
Right. I don't think that's healthy. I think that's very bad. And then if you're in the heat, it could really damage you. And the other thing is that you do get so hot that you can actually overextend and overstretch. So you can actually hurt yourself without knowing it.
Wow.
So those are my problems with the Bikram.
There is a place I really love, Komodo. Not endorsed.
Okay.
Yeah, it's one in Williamsburg, one in the city. Komodo is super clean. It's spiritual. It's very calm. I like the yin because it's more passive.
Uh-huh.
And you hold the pose for 3 to 5 minutes.
Wow. That gets you really, really focused.
And you're almost having visions.
Yes, I do love that. I love, there's the balancing poses when you're standing on one foot a lot of time, the tree pose.
Yeah.
Those I do get locked into. I feel that same feeling of like, whoa, I'm going into hyper-focus. You know, and it's in today's world, I think that's pretty important to have those moments.
Like every day.
Yeah, well, that would be nice. Mm-hmm. That would be ideal.
It's kind of like substitute meditation for me, because I already feel like when I took the class, I had that moment to myself.
That's true. That does, sometimes. You can check that off in some, you know, if you're like, okay, I kind of meditated today and you're
kind of
better than not doing it.
So, nowadays, what are your routines look like? Like when you, what time do you wake up? What time do you go to bed? Like just pick any days of the week.
I have, since we have a 5-year-old son, I'm exhausted by the end of the day. And when I put him to bed, I still lay down with him.
Mm-hmm.
And he asks me not to go. And I am such a pushover that I'm like, okay, buddy. Now the new thing is, but I gotta go make your lunch. And then somehow that's okay because it's still about him.
Mm-hmm.
So he maybe lets me go, but usually I'll stay.
Until he falls asleep.
Until he falls asleep, which I've read that's not a good idea, but it's really hard habit to break for me. I know it's hard for me to leave. He'll be crying. I don't want him to cry. You know, I don't want to have a scene.
How old is he now?
He's 5. It's 5. You know, that's
only 5.
I mean, some mothers are like, "Oh, I do that too," and that makes me feel better. Mm. But I also know, like, I've read those textbooks and I've talked to those therapists, and they're like, "You gotta let him sleep on his own." You know, so okay, I'm working
on
that.
Well, some families sleep together.
That's right.
Like, there are so many schools.
Exactly. Come on, there's other things that you need to worry about what you're doing wrong. And that's one thing that I'm like, please give
me
that.
You know best. You know what's best for you and for him.
I also think that there's going to be a time very soon when he's going to be like, no, thank you.
So <I'm laughs> what are you doing?
Yeah, and we do pretzel legs. We call it pretzel legs. And we get close and cozy and we call it cosi fan tutti. And, you know, we just like snuggle. He used to say, hold me tight. So I am not going to feel bad about those moments where it's just heaven. Anyway, if I don't fall asleep myself, which is very often the case, I'll get up and then I'll either go make his lunch and then I'm tired. I'm done at 9. But then Selman's our son, he'll wake us up in the morning. I don't even have to set an alarm clock. He'll be like, Mom, at about 6:30.
Wow.
Yeah. He calls me into his room.
On time.
Yep. Pretty much.
And then do you get to, do work on your music and everything else when he's at school?
That's was supposed to be the idea. Everyone was like, oh, don't worry. Now he's in kindergarten. You can have your time back and you'll be working on your music. But I haven't quite figured that puzzle piece out yet. Living in New York is difficult to have the space to do
Yes.
Yeah, you don't want your neighbors to hear you. I don't really have a studio in New York. I used to have like the closet that, you know, was my studio, and I had like little instruments in there, but I don't have that in this apartment because, like,
it's very quiet.
It is very quiet, but people they're walking by. They can hear me.
You had a piano.
And yes, and when I've had to practice for a gig, sometimes I'm like, oh, well, they're going to hear me. They're just going to hear me. It's New York.
It's
you know.
Lucky for them.
It is. That's right. We get a free show.
Good music.
Yeah. And in our building, we've got a lot of artistic people across the hallway. Is like a, she's a professional clown, you know. So I think I'm like, you know, she's probably digging this right now. But it's when I have to practice things over and over again, like say I'm not getting it right. That's when I kind of worry about my neighbors. I'm like, sorry, but I got to practice this. I'm not getting it. But that's what you, that's, you know, I've been doing that since I was... you know, young, in dormitories and things like that, worrying about other people hearing me practice. And then at some point you just have to say, like, whatever, we're in a city.
And on the weekends you would go up to Woodstock.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. It's quieter.
That is so nice.
Yeah.
Because like, I think one thing about New Yorkers, we love it here. We're city people, but we do need that getaway.
I think everyone needs a little grass under their feet, right? Bare feet, grass. So you can actually look up, because I think New Yorkers forget to look up here, too. There's a sky up there, and there's stars up there.
Yes.
But we won't. We don't even really know
it's too bright to see the stars.
It's too bright to see the stars. Yeah, yeah. But up there, oh, my gosh, sometimes we look up, and we just can't believe the beauty.
Wow.
It's amazing. And then the smell. Sometimes you have a campfire, and you smell like the campfire. Those are my favorite things.
Burning wood.
Yeah.
And then you look forward to the new week when you come down, or you don't want to come back?
Well, yeah, exactly. It's hard. I just psych myself up. I enjoy what I do. I started teaching recently, and I'm teaching some really young kids with some of my original music that's geared towards the young kids, and I actually really am starting to enjoy it. So I don't dread coming back to the city. It's fun. It's really fun.
I saw a video of your students.
Yeah.
They were all like lining up and playing that game.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
What do you call it?
Well, I don't know what to call it.
You
but
call
it's...
a note and they're like music notes. They have to like touch it with their
on the
right
floor.
Arm,
yeah.
Left arm.
It's like Twister. It's like Twister and it's kind of yoga too. But they have to identify the note on the staff that I've made on the floor with painter's tape.
It's like life size.
Yes, exactly. It's huge, and it's for their body. You know, they can. I can say like, okay, right hand goes on an E. That's a space, and they have to go there. And then usually I try to make it tricky so that they're doing this.
Oh, you specify it. Yeah, like in the space rather than on the line, so they know not the closer one.
Yes, exactly, okay. Exactly. I know, because if they know it, they will cheat. They'll be like, oh, there's an E right there. And I'm like, no, I mean the space, and then they have to go up here. And I feel like it's kinesthetic learning. They will learn, and it'll lock into their brains a lot more permanently if they're using their bodies.
Yeah, because it's like in your system.
Yeah, yeah. It's really fun to, when kids are into that game, I have a blast. It's really cute. And then I've got versions of those kinds of things for younger kids too, who are not quite ready to read music notes. But there's little dots that we can use for do, mi, so, you know, little lily pads, do, re, mi, fa, so. It's very fun.
Did you trademark it?
I think I should.
You should.
I know, I really,
it comes
I've got
with
all these,
a giant fabric.
Yes, exactly. And I want to like start trademarking it and like licensing it to schools and don't get this idea before me.
It is so
but
fun.
Yeah, I really, I can't stop with the ideas. They're coming too fast. I don't even know what I'm, I got to market this stuff and, you know, brand it or whatever, but.
You're the visionary. You need some people
I need a business partner. Exactly. I need somebody who just comes in and does like, okay, you need to like go and get that patented and call that person and. Yeah.
Does Salmon like music?
Yeah, he loves music. He's a rocker. He's totally into Black Sabbath. And I taught him how to play Iron Man on the piano. And so that's all. He goes up to the piano. It's very cute. It's his favorite thing.
So he'll probably learn soon.
I think so. What I'm not pushing it too much. I've given him some lessons and he's enjoyed it. But he's also, you know, a little bit like, Mom, stop telling me what to do. So, and he's only 5 and I do feel like he's just too young. It's a really important, I think, for kids to be exposed to it, but not to be pushed to music unless they show a real interest and they have the ability to focus. But I haven't met a 5-year-old that can do that yet. I think 8 years old is a good time to start saying, okay, let's do some lessons. Let's find a teacher.
Okay.
But up until then, I think you expose them as much as possible so that they see people enjoying it.
Yes.
That's what I did. I saw my mom on stage and I was like, wow, that looks like fun. And that's what when the seed was planted.
You started singing at 5.
Yeah.
And then you started playing violin and then piano.
Right. And then piano, exactly.
Yeah.
And my mom didn't have to push me at all. It was just like, okay, that's what I'm going to do. Done.
That is actually a good point. I started playing piano at 6, and when I practiced, I kicked the piano. I was like, oh, I didn't want to do
it. You were forced to do it? You were
I thought so, but I said I wanted to, and then I just changed my mind because I didn't like practicing.
Yes, right. I know. Right. You need to be older to kind of get and enjoy the practicing part, the improving part.
Yeah.
But it depends on your teacher. Because if your teacher can make that process really fun, where you come back next week and you're like, look, and maybe you have a little chart like, oh, I did all of these days and it was only 15 minutes a day, but I did them and I get a sticker. So it's all this like motivational tricks.
Yeah.
Then you can like hook them.
True.
Yeah.
So we'll see what he likes.
Yeah, we'll see what he likes.
His background inspired your Wax and Gold album from 2015, right?
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
I always wanted to ask you this question with Wax and Gold. Can you tell us the meaning behind it again and give us an example of what are the, is that the proverb set has double meaning?
Right, double meaning. I will try my best. It's somehow very elusive to me, this concept, even though I love it, and that's why I chose the title Wax and Gold.
Mm.
So where my son is from is Ethiopia, and they have this cultural tradition that was kind of passed down through the generations of their storytelling and then their literature. They have a term called wax and gold. And the wax represents the surface meaning, and then the gold is a meaning underneath it. And usually, and what they actually try to do in this art form is they try to have them be two despairing meanings, two different things.
Uh-huh.
Not just a subtle thing underneath, two different things going on there. That's what confuses me. I don't know if I've been able to master that yet because it's very interesting. But it'll be, you know, it'll be one line, but it'll have like two completely different meanings.
Uh-huh.
That blows my mind. And it's very interesting because we spent a little time in Ethiopia and we had also read that it started to kind of permeate through the culture in their daily speak. And we found that. It was kind of confusing. We were like, okay, we're going to meet at such and such place. And they'd be like, yeah, you know, and then, but it meant no. It wasn't quite like that simple, but like it was confusing. Like, okay, what are they meaning when they say that?
So you have to live there for a while to figure it out.
To decipher, coding. Yeah.
Is it simple to them, the locals?
I think it must be. And there's literature on the internet about it. And I researched it. Anybody can kind of look up wax and gold, and there's books written about it. So it's still fascinating to me. I still quite haven't grasped it. And I don't think I could give you an example at this moment because I draw a blank. I'm like very intimidated by the whole idea of it. I don't know.
But that's something that if it's not simple, we can research and we can go deep and
absolutely
find out. Okay.
There's plenty of stuff out there. But yeah,
it's like a mystery.
Yes. It's okay. Like invisible ink.
That's true. So. I'm excited to go down that
rabbit hole.
There are three questions that I always ask my guests at the end of the interview.
Right.
So question number one for you is if you can Skype, FaceTime, or Google Hangout with the 20-year-old Tracy, what would you say to her?
I would say, Tracy, that guy you're with, you think he's ruining your life. And it feels like he's ruining your life, but you will be the phoenix that rises from the ashes and you will actually write your whole first album about him and it'll do well. So just get in there, do whatever you have to do, work it out, and then leave him. Thank God I did. And then my album will, you know, I'll tell my story to the world. But don't worry, it's not going to last forever.
Wow.
Yeah.
Because at the time, you thought that's like...
I was trapped. I was, you know, 20, and I was like, I was afraid of breaking up with him. I was afraid of making the change. I was afraid of being alone. And so I just kept getting sucked back into it, and it was so dysfunctional and so terrible and just a bad situation all the way around. But I just couldn't get out of it.
At which point did you start writing about it?
It was a couple of years after. It took me a while. I was like a weeble. I was like trying to figure my life out after that. It took a while because it was one of those like life changer. Like what? Who was I? Like I felt like I was a different person.
Looking back,
exactly. Yeah. Just how did I let those things happen? How did I allow it? But also good to, you know, I can't really regret anything that I've done, but I can look back and learn from it.
Mm. So in a way, to apply to now, whatever we feel that, oh, my life is ending,
yeah,
it might not be.
No, there's always tomorrow, you know, just kind of pull yourself through and you know, this too shall pass.
Good advice. Yeah. Okay, number two, it has four parts.
Okay.
Can you give us... a little tips, hints, to teach us how to balance life in these four areas.
Okay.
Health,
yeah.
Wealth, love, and happiness.
Okay. Health, wealth, love, and happiness. Well, health. I think that keeping a positive mental attitude is going to definitely affect one's health. Now, no matter what a person is going through, no matter what cards they've been dealt, this is always going to take one through any difficulties. And I think it can actually, you know, influence your cellular structure. So I think that, you know, of course, there's obvious things, eating well, exercising, getting enough sleep, and try not to be stressed out. But I think like the positive mental attitude and visualizing can definitely make all of those things in one package, you know, enhance your health and your life.
Hmm. You're always in great shape. And
well, yeah, I need to remember those things. Like, okay, note to self.
And yoga.
And yoga, for sure, yeah.
Okay, so wealth.
Wealth is a subjective term, so I like to call it abundance.
Mm.
And again, it's one of these things where it's your perspective and what you believe it to be. And if you believe yourself to be abundant no matter what, if you're living in a, you know, tiny cracker box apartment, but you're abundant because you have a lot of friends, then you are wealthy. And I think when you start, just like the positive attitude, when you really start to believe that you are abundant, then things actually come to you. I'm working on it. It's a work in progress. It's kind of a lifelong challenge and journey. But if you act and live as if you are abundant, the universe will give you what you need. May not be money. It may turn into money. Who knows? But it will give you what you need.
Wow. So we can measure our wealth with people that care about us or we care, then we're all really wealthy.
Yeah.
So rich.
Yeah, exactly. What more do you need?
So then what about health of love?
Love.
Who? How did you find love? How and self-love?
Oh, self-love. Well, you know, I can just give you something that I'm doing these days because it comes and goes. And I even write songs to myself, you know, like, where are you? Or, you know, God, I wish you. But I'm doing something these days that helps me find that inner respect and love, and also just acceptance. So that's a huge one for people. It's hard to accept the things that you think are your flaws. It's hard to accept, you know, where you're at sometimes. Maybe you don't feel like you've achieved all the things you need to achieve. Why do I always forget these things? You know, why? And then you start getting down on yourself. But if you can learn to accept and to realize that there's no right or wrong or perfect scenario, then you can let go of all of that negativity and find your divinity inside, which then can permeate. So I think it's really important to just not get down on ourselves. I do it a lot. And then I have to kind of recalibrate. Go, oh yeah, I'm doing that thing that I used to do. Acceptance.
Acceptance.
Yeah.
In a way, it's love.
Exactly. Exactly, wow. Yeah.
And happiness.
Happiness.
Do you think you're a happy person?
Well, I know I'm a happy person in there, but I do get caught up. I get caught up with other things, external things. I need to meditate more. I need to do more yoga. I need to do exactly what I'm preaching here. I need to do it myself, because I can get sucked into other people's energies, and I can get sucked into other people's expectations, and then that will get me really kind of up in my head, and then I start to kind of get frustrated, and then find myself not in the place that I would rather be and really feel I should be. So the more that I try to weed that garden, because the weeds can grow. If you stop doing your spiritual work or your meditation, those weeds are going to grow. They're just going to grow. So I think like a regular practice, and again, I'm like note to self of meditating and doing that spiritual journey, that is going to lead you to happiness, because it's going to be the absence of all of that stuff that you get sucked into, all the weeds popping up.
And it's important to remember it's not a one-time thing. It's like almost like a
It's not habit, a one-time thing. Right? Think of, like, I love the metaphor of a garden. Just think about it. Yeah, you go out and you weed and you're like, ah, I'm done. And then like 2 weeks later, and it's July, and maybe there's been a lot of rains too, and 2 weeks later you're like, what are all these weeds doing here? You know, you have to go out and do the manual labor. Same here. Because there's the ego up there, and the ego wants to take you down. It just wants to. It wants to mess with you. It doesn't want you to be happy. It doesn't. So, and I don't know why. It just feeds on that negativity. You have to keep this ego. You have to remember that there's the ego, and it's not always your friend. You know, some people can use it to their advantage, but it's not always your friend. You got to quiet.
Tame your ego.
Go to sleep. Exactly. So that you can really be your authentic self.
I've been using this productivity planner. And in the beginning, it also says that don't think that you plan, you do it, and it's done. It's like they use taking a bath, taking a shower as an example. Kind of like working in the garden.
Yes, it's what you do every day. Brush your teeth, right? You don't want to walk out with, you know, morning breath. Same thing, exactly. I had a meditation teacher that would tell me that too, and it's really true. Think of it as like putting your shirt on. But it's still so hard. It's still just so easy to just be like, nah, I'll do it later. And then you don't do it.
Yes, we have to trust that we know that's going to be good. And just do it, and then you feel rewarded.
That's true. You have to trust it, because a lot of times you might think, oh, it's not doing anything. There's no like physical change at that moment that you can be like, okay, yeah, I can see. So, I think it's very easy to just let it go.
Our minds are so tricky.
Oh, they're so tricky. Little bastards.
Last question.
Okay.
What is your favorite memory of New York City?
Okay. I've been doing some thinking here, because there's many, many, many.
You can share more than one.
Okay. Well, I have this one idea, because I couldn't really think of one that stood out. I love New York so much. And I love the people and the food and the art and the music. But what happened when I moved to Los Angeles for 3 years, I tried it after being in New York, kind of considered myself a New Yorker. And then after 2001, after 9/11, happened a couple years after that, I was like, I can't deal with the fear anymore. I don't, you know, I was like wearing gloves to check my mailbox because there was the anthrax thing, mm-hmm, and you know, and there was like military people on the Brooklyn Bridge. I couldn't live like this. So I wanted to escape, and I went to LA for 3 years. But my favorite New York experience was when I was not in New York. I had this, well, it was an ongoing thing. I realized, the realization was, I am a New Yorker. Like, it's in here, and I can't stop talking about it. And everybody over there is comparing, because a lot of people do the same thing. They're moving away, but they love it so much, and they're, you know.
So you connected with New Yorkers in LA.
I connected with New Yorkers over there. We're all talking about New York and the difference, and nobody could actually, like, fully commit to the LA life. I know, but New York is so much better, because you can strike up a conversation with a guy next to you, and in LA, nobody's interesting. And so when I had that realization of like, oh my God, I need to go back because it's my village. I felt like it's like, these are the people in your neighborhood. The is it Sesame Street or is it Mr. Rogers? Either way, it's like, I came back and I was like, hey, Bing, the postman. Hey, how you doing? Hey, hi, you at the falafel joint. And hi, everybody's like, welcome back. You know, that's when I was like, oh, this is where I'm most comfortable. There's the people. It's the village.
Have you visited during the 3 years?
Yes, I kept coming back. They kept pulling me back in, you know? And I was like, ah, I love it here. Why, you know, it's hard to have the best of both worlds, and that's why I think we got the country home in Woodstock, so that there could be like this, you know, other setting.
Yes.
Like you said, if you're just in New York, it can really kind of wear you down.
So, but why do we feel that in New York we're like a little trapped, and we feel like we want to go somewhere?
It's the dilemma. I think it's the New Yorker dilemma. We can't get away from it. It's like it's like a drug habit in a way. Like, you can't get away, but you complain about it all the time. But you love it, and you would never dream of really getting away. Mm. But I think it's important. That's why zip cars exist. I think it's important to get a zip car and go up to the Hudson River Valley and do some, you know, get out of the city so you can come back and feel refreshed. Mm. But there's nothing like it. There's nothing like the energy and the people and the inspiration. And if I was only up in the country, I might be like, who do we talk to, you know? So it's really, I'm lucky to have both.
Wow, that's a first. The New York City memory that's not in
New York City, exactly. Yeah.
Is there anything else that you want to tell us? Tracy news?
Let me think about this. Any Tracy news? Well, so, just quickly, like I brushed on the kids' music thing, I'm very excited because I do have a new album in the works. But it's not exactly a Tracy Bonham album. It's kind of a Tracy Bonham's kids' album. I see the artwork right now. I'm going to have like a clown nose. But it's still me, but it's these songs that I've been really enjoying teaching because they have an educational aspect to it. They're funny, in my opinion. They're funny, they're kind of groovy, mm-hmm. They got a retro thing going on, kind of like Sesame Street or Electric Company back in the 70s. But they're educational. They have, you know, the rudiments of music theory inside the song. And I just, that's kind of my favorite subject. So that is very exciting to me.
That's wonderful. Yeah. And your friends and fans, they can now get it for their next generation.
Exactly. They can. Maybe they all can enjoy it. This is what I'm hoping, is that the music is fun enough for the parents and the kids to enjoy. And maybe they might learn a little something about music theory if they need to.
I see that a lot of parents are learning with the kids.
Yeah. So. Yeah, it's good.
That's fantastic.
It's good. Yeah.
So do you know when it's coming out?
I don't know when, but I know it's going to be soon.
Okay. I will update my New York Realers.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tracy.
Thank you.
This is such a pleasure.
It was fun.
Thank you.
Get ahead of me.
You're my love, I love.
If you wanna call me. princess.